The attempt to understand where hominins began is really an attempt to figure out what are the key features that began that process of distinguishing humans, or what would become humans, from apes, or what would become the living apes that we see today. Two features have been consistently evoked to help explain this early divergence between humans and apes, the origin of the hominins. One of these features, which has been very commonly evoked, even going back to the time of Darwin, is the reduction in the size of the canines. Great apes, as you recall, have large projecting canines. Humans, on the other hand, have small, reduced canines. There are other differences in canine form and function between humans and great apes that require further understanding in order to try and interpret why the early reduction of canines may have been important for the origin of the hominins. First, let's take a step back and review what we know about canine morphology in the great apes. Here's a good example of a great ape with large projecting canines. We can see these projecting canines very clearly here, and there are a number of features about these canines that reflect both their large size, but also the function that they serve for this primate. First of all, if we zoom in close, we can see that these canines have a particular shape to them. They're sharp with both an anterior and posterior edge to the tooth, giving it a diamond-like or dagger-like structure. This form comes because of the interplay between the upper teeth, the upper canines, and the lower dentition, particularly the lower canine and the lower third premolar. Now we can see this relationship very clearly if we look at this large gorilla that we have here. You can see how the lower canines project into a space between the upper canine and the lateral incisor. Likewise, the upper canine projects into a space between the lower canine and the lower third premolar. This is what's known as a honing complex. And basically what it creates is a structure where the upper and lower dentition rub against each other, creating particularly the sharp honing edge on the posterior edge of the canine that we observed before on the orangutan. This basically creates this tooth into a projecting dagger that's continually sharpening itself against the lower dentition. There are a number of anatomical features that indicate the presence of this kind of a honing complex that are observable on both the maxilla and the mandible of the specimens. First of all, the fact that the canine is large and projecting allows for this structure to exist. It creates the situation in which those teeth come in contact with each other and create this sharp honing edge. The second feature you see on the upper jaw is this space between the canine and the lateral incisor, referred to as a diastema. This is the space that allows for that lower canine to articulate with the upper jaw without coming into direct contact with the teeth. If we look at the lower jaw, the mandible, we can also see evidence of this anatomical complex. Again, here we see the canines and the third premolar. And in the lower jaw, again, the canines are projecting. They again sometimes have a sharp honing facet along their posterior edge. But we can especially see that the third premolar, that tooth that immediately sits behind the canine, takes on a specialized morphology associated with its articulation with the upper canine. The upper canine, you recall, sits in between these two teeth, in between the canine and the premolar. In rubbing against the anterior portion of the third premolar takes on a distinctive morphology associated with this honing complex. So in the great apes, we have a number of anatomical features that indicate the presence of a honing complex. Now we can contrast this with the morphology we see in humans. If we look at human morphology, we see no evidence of projecting canines. Despite vampire stories to the contrary, we see no evidence of a honing complex, and none of that morphology exists. Humans have very reduced canines. Now, it's important to point out that in both humans and primates, canine size is variable. We can see that illustrated in these two canine jaws, in which the canine in this specimen on the left is much larger than the canines in the specimen on the right. These canines are barely projecting at all, and by projecting I mean above the surface of the other teeth around them. This is normal variability. One of the reasons this variability exists is that amongst the primates, canines are a feature that are oftentimes sexually dimorphic, meaning males have much larger canines than females. Gorillas, for example, males have dramatically larger canines than female gorillas. The same is true in chimpanzees. Across the primates, canine dimorphism has been shown to be correlated with reproductive competition. Species in which males are engaged in some kind of competition for limited reproductive access tend to have more evidence of canine dimorphism. Now, interestingly, humans we tend to think of as monogamous, although this might be a reduction in the true complexity of what we think of as human sexual behavior. But humans have reduced canines and not much sexual dimorphism in their canines. The only other ape that has no canine dimorphism or insignificant canine dimorphism is the gibbon, what we consider a lesser ape from Southeast Asia. Interestingly, however, the pattern of no dimorphism that we see in gibbons is associated with large expanded canines in both males and females. So in this sense, the reduced canines that we see in humans are an anomaly. They're not like the pattern that we observe amongst other primates. And it's hard to know for sure whether or not they indicate changes in reproductive strategies in humans or simply other anatomical or evolutionary changes in the species. Now, it's important at this point to take a step back and think about what's the big deal about canines? Why does it matter if the canines are large or small? Again, we can look at primates and think about how primates use these canines. In old world monkeys and the great apes, species that have very large canines, especially the males, oftentimes use them as weapons in male-male competition. We regularly see this amongst baboons, for example, a species of monkey that's found throughout Africa, in which males not only display their canines to each other, so they have big gaping jaws that allow you to see how big their canines are, but they actually use them as weapons to physically harm males in competition, oftentimes that competition associated with reproductive behaviors. So canines, at least one of their functions, is to serve as a physical weapon. A weapon that especially the males possess to use against each other or perhaps against other kinds of predators that they might face. Not surprisingly, the early interpretations of the reduction in canine size in humans, going again back to Darwin, were that the reduction of canine size correlated with the need for an alternative weapon or perhaps the presence of an alternative kind of weapon. Darwin thought reduction of canine size was associated with bipedality, in part because the movement to bipedality frees up the arms to carry things. One of the things you can carry in your free hands are weapons or other kinds of tools. This was a model that Darwin put forward, basically that canine reduction went along with the movement of bipedality because bipedality freed up the arms so that you didn't need those large canines. You could carry other kinds of weapons. Now, as it turns out, and we'll get to this in a few weeks when we begin moving forward in the unit, but the origin of at least durable stone tools doesn't come about till several million years after the origins of bipedality. So Darwin's model for this was likely overly simplified or incorrect in the sense that the origin of bipedality and the origin of stone tools aren't linked within the fossil record. They're separated by several million years. So we have to look to other explanations to potentially understand why the reduction in canine size is important. The notion that canine size is somehow connected to reproductive strategies is an argument that's been invoked to explain some of the fossil variation that we see in the earliest putative hominins. One argument is that the origin of hominins is associated with a movement to more monogamous styles of reproductive behavior, particularly styles that involve less male-male competition for female mating partners, and also more partnership between males and females. And by more partnership, what we really mean here is males provisioning females with resources. By males providing females with more resources, it's possible that females are able to reproduce more frequently, creating more reproductive potential for hominins. This is an argument, however, that doesn't fully explain the pattern of variation that we see. Again, if we look at the early hominin record, as we will in the next few weeks, we're going to see that there's a lot of variation in canine size in the earliest hominins. Some have very large canines that almost appear to create some kind of a honing complex, even if not the fully articulated honing complex that we see in the great apes, whereas others have very small reduced canine size. Furthermore, the lack of soft tissue preservation, the lack of direct access to reproductive strategies in these hominins makes the argument of the direct association between canine size and reproductive behavior very difficult to test within the fossil record. It might be an idea, it might be something we want to keep in the back of our head as a hypothesis, but it's something that's difficult to test with the current available fossil evidence. So while canine size and reduction in canine size remains an anatomical feature that is commonly and regularly invoked with the origin of hominins, it's not one that we have a clear understanding as to its importance and exactly why it's associated with this development.